Okay, welcome to the short course on modeling and simulation of nanotransistors. I am really glad to see people from all over India, not only India but outside India. From we have from France, Bangladesh, UAE, US, so really glad to see the gathering, and I hope few more will join. So let's say start. So this short course will cover all the way from device physics to devices, and then circuits also, modeling, simulation, characterization, measurements. So you will have everything all compressed in 5 days. The goal here will be to give you glimpse of in all these areas. Don't expect you will become expert or we can talk everything in this in these 5 days. What we are actually talking in these 5 days are covered in at least 4 or 5 courses in a semester. So now just imagine, we cover all these details in approximately 200 to 300 hours compressed in few hours. Okay, so just to tell you the purpose of this short course or what you at the end you will be learning. So let's say you have a device, take MOSFET. You want to understand what's going on inside MOSFET, how it works, right? So that is one is the inside device physics, which you are going to hear. Another one is that let me do the simulation. Let me change what's the impact of doping, what's the impact of length, width, etc. So this is what we call the TCAD simulation. You can simulate the device in the software and actually analyze the characteristics. Once you have a good device, whether a standard device or a normal device or your exotic device, then you can use that for circuit simulation. That's your end goal, that we have a device, now let me use for circuit simulation. But for circuit simulation, you need a model. And that model is what we call compact model. And you will be in this course learning about the compact modeling. So once you have developed a compact model, you will put it in a software code, which is we put it in Verilog A code. So this is again, you will do a hands-on on Verilog A coding of any model. And once you have done the Verilog A, put the model in the Verilog A code, you can do the circuit simulation. And this is called SPICE simulation. So you will be again doing hands-on on SPICE simulation. Okay. And once you have done all this, you would like to extract the parameters. So this is called parameter extraction, which again you will be doing here. And once you have done all those things, you want to see how it works with the device and circuit level. So this is where we will have the characterization part, including a high frequency RF load pull, all these things of power amplifier or the gallium nitride devices. So we will really cover variety of topics in this course. Feel free to ask questions, feel free to interact with faculty members, speakers, and also feel free to visit IITK campus. So with that short introduction, I would like to invite Professor Harish, who is the head of the Department of Electrical Engineering, to say a few words.
Good morning. Welcome to IIT Kanpur. Welcome to Electrical Department, IIT Kanpur. Hearing out what Yogesh said about the expanse of the course, I'm really excited to attend this course myself. I'm sure you're all looking forward to learning something new and firming up the concept that you have already learned. More importantly, you want to convert some of those ideas and concepts that you have into reality. Probably the last one is what I'm more interested in talking about today. usually in a class, what happens is we end up teaching an equation, a model, a procedure or something. And the class ends with an examination. Student is happy, got a good grade. Teacher is happy, got a good rating for the course. And probably that's the end of it. Whereas a short course is a little different. It goes one step ahead of it. This is where you get an opportunity to ask those questions which always intrigued you, didn't know where to find the answer. This is the platform. In this short course, you would see faculty people speaking, not just faculty members of electrical department, IIT Kanpur, probably people from physics department, students of IIT Kanpur, and faculty members and industrial collaborators from outside. I invite all of them. I thank all of them for contributing to this short course. You will see a lot of diversity. You will see a lot of variation in the way things are presented. And that's part of life. That's the point that gives you an opportunity to pick up which thread, which path you would want to carry on with your research, with your objective. Please keep that also in your mind. See how you would want to progress yourself in this domain of modeling. Nano transistor modeling. Don't ask me what is nano. I always thought transistor is very narrow, very small. So something which probably end of the course you will be able to answer. I was talking to Yogesh about this course, how he plans to conduct the course. What I understand is something very interesting. You're going to have conventional lectures the way I'm talking, but you will also get an opportunity to try out some of these things on your laptop. I hope you all have your laptops with you. They have created some kind of virtual machine or something with licensed software. So you will get a hands-on real experience with these software and how to use them, how to extract information out of them, results out of them. But it doesn't stop there. We have a wonderful characterization facility, and Yogesh has planned some visits. Probably he might not have planned about you actually doing experiments there, but you get a glimpse of what's available. And trust me, if you are interested in using any of the facility, please don't hesitate to contact one of us. We'll see how it can be arranged for you. We do have a lot of students coming from outside, researchers, industrial people coming from outside who access our facilities in the department, and we encourage it. Some of the facilities are free. Some of them we charge. That's a nominal fee. But we do encourage outside people, outside participation in using the facility, in keeping up the facility growing. This time, the winter has not been very harsh, but I'm happy that you're all well protected in this room. But make sure you protect yourself when you're outside roaming around. We have a beautiful campus, and the beautiful campus is dotted by a beautiful bird called peacock. They won't dance in this time of the year, unfortunately, but you do get to see them. Some of them are very friendly. You can go very close to them. Trust me, they won't bite you. I wish you a pleasant stay here and an enjoyable experience. And please take home some good memories of IIT Kanpur. If you end up getting any bad experience, don't take them home. Deliver them to me. Transfer them to me. I'll take care of it. This time can't be done. It's over. For the next time, we'll take precautions so that such things won't happen. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank all the speakers and industrial participants here who have come all the way from various parts of the world. And it's your participation here which makes such a course a success. I wish you a great time and thank you.
Thank you, Professor Harish. Just to reiterate, you will be really talking and meeting the people who are doing cutting-edge research in different areas, including industry, who are using some of these things, and also what they are doing. I can say that what you are going to see in this short course will be something you would not have seen anywhere else. Really doing all the way from deep physics all to the industry user. We also have Professor Amit Agrawal, who is the co-coordinator of this short course. So please, few words. And then we move on.
So very, very warm welcome to all the participants and to all the other dignitaries, invited speakers, and so on. So I'm a physicist by training. I'm in the physics department here, but I work closely with Yogesh. Because that's where technology is taking us. So the amalgamation of, let's say, basic sciences and technology together. Most of the new fields which are being developed, you'll see, are at the forefront of emerging different fields, basically. So physics and electrical engineering can be one, for example. By training, for example, I may not care about compact model at all. All I care about is what is the correct transport model being used, what is the physics, and so on. But, that is not that useful, even though I may enjoy it more. So to make it more useful, I have to combine resources with, let's say, electrical engineers and so on and so forth. So that's the main point, that, amalgamation of technologies, something, if you can combine, then you create something new. One and one, you can maybe make it into 11. If not 11, maybe 5 and 6 definitely, but definitely more than 2. That is one thing. So welcome once again. Please be very informal. Feel free to ask any question to any speaker at any time. That is very, very important. We do not want to go home without answers, right? Even if you ask questions, sometimes we may not get answers, right? But at least we would have attempted, because the speaker may not know themselves. So please ask lots of questions. Please interact with, us, our students, other visitors, other dignitaries, so that you get a broad vision of what is actually happening in the field, how people are working. Sometimes for younger colleagues, at least when I was younger, it was very important to just see how, people who are, let's say, at the forefront of the field are working. How do they think? And it was a delight to discover that, they think just like me. Even if you are younger, just that, they're working a bit more, maybe more experienced, and that's it, basically. So that was a delight to know that we are also there. I mean, not far behind, we're on the right path, basically. And then our campus is very, very nice, pleasant to stay in at this time of the year. So, walk around, visit, etc. And please feel free to interact with our students. They are experts in a lot of compact modeling, ab initio calculations, transport models, physics-based models, and so on and so forth. And you will hear more from them. So ask a lot of questions, please.
Thank you. So without delay, before starting, few announcements. Please keep your mobile in the silent mode. Wear your course badge all the time. Just to clarify on the lunch and meals. So all those who are staying in VH extension, whether male or female, will take breakfast and dinner in hall 12. All those who are staying in GH tower, girls hostel tower, will take all the meals, breakfast, lunch, and dinner in GS tower. All those who are staying other than these two will take breakfast and dinner in the respective hall, but the lunch will be in hall 3. And so during the when we have lunch break, someone will take you there, we have planned characterization lab visit all days, all 5 days. Our characterization lab cannot accommodate a lot of people, and also it's sensitive in the sense we have very expensive equipment, somewhere around 10 crore or so, so very expensive. So we will only take few each time. That means we will divide you in like maybe group of 20-30 people and then take you and explain you there. Attendance will be there on all days, so a seat will be forwarded you, passed to you. Hands-on, as Professor Hari has already explained, so we have a let's say software package, we will ask you to put it in your laptop. Since it's a 17 GB, so we will pass you a pen drive. And you know what you can do when you have break, take your laptop outside, and the volunteers are there, and then they will copy the software in your laptop. Okay. That's it. And with that, let's start the program. So we have first lecture by Professor Amit Verma from Department of Electrical Engineering, and he will be talking about physics of semiconductor devices. Okay, you are going to copy now, right? Okay. So I will ask him to introduce himself.
All right, so good morning, everyone. So welcome to IIT Kanpur. So we are just starting the proceedings now. So first lecture is, so as you know, all devices first start from materials, right? So you have some semiconductor material, you do lots of engineering with it, doping, making heterostructures, making junctions, and you get very unique behavior in devices because of all that. So this lecture is kind of getting you into that, and then rest of the course will of course focus a lot more on devices. So as Professor Amit said, please feel free to interact. I mean, just stop me anytime, ask questions. Okay. So let's keep this very informal. So I'm a faculty in Department of Electrical Engineering. So yeah, you can catch me, or if you have any questions, you can always drop me an email at that ID also. So let's get started. So see, what gives semiconductor devices its functionality? Okay. So why are they useful for us? So what I would claim that devices are useful because of their very unique IV characteristics, at least for electrical engineers. Okay. So one example would be, so we have this device called diode, which have this very interesting property that it allows the current to go in one direction, but does not allow current to go when you apply a bias in the reverse direction. Okay? And this very simple IV characteristics, but which is non-trivial, allows you to use this device to make rectifiers, to convert AC to DC, and a lot of other applications. Similarly, we have devices like this, which are called tunnel diodes, either resonant tunneling diode or something else. Now, this has a very interesting IV characteristic, that at some part of its IV characteristics, its local slope is negative. Okay? So it shows a negative resistance effectively there. Because of this unique property, what you can do is use this device to make high frequency oscillators. So again, how IV characteristics leads to very useful device applications. And there are a lot of other devices. So if you have a device like this, so this may be a solar cell, this might be a diode on which you are shining light. And you see that the IV characteristics go into this quadrant in which voltage is positive and current is negative. So you can use it now as a power source. And this you are very familiar with, right? So if you have a device which shows characteristics like this, in which it's a three-terminal device, in which you change the bias, a current or a voltage on the third terminal, and you can control what current flows through the other two terminals. If you have a device like this, or a current voltage characteristics like this, you can make a very good amplifier with it. Okay? Or you can make a switch. So you can do all kinds of logic, all kinds of communication with a device that has IV characteristics like this. Okay? And then there are more crazier devices. Okay? So something like shows like this, metal insulated transitions, or more recently devices which show hysteresis loop like this. They're called memristors, which have resistors, which have memory embedded in them. And currently people are doing research, significant research on interesting IV characteristics like this, how to get them in devices. And they can be used for applications like neuromorphic computing and other applications. Okay. So main thing is that interesting IV characteristics actually lead to device applications. So in this lecture, what I will try to show you is actually how do we get these interesting IV characteristics? Okay? How to design them? And of course, then circuit designers, what they do is they start from IV characteristics and then make interesting circuits and systems out of them. Okay? So let's start looking at the first part. So what is current? Okay? So IV, these are the two components we have to look at. So, you know, current is, so if you have a conductor like this, in which there are some free carriers, okay? So how do you define current? So current is, if you have some kind of a cross section like this, you sit there and then count that how many carriers are actually going from one side to the other. So what is the net flow of carriers? And if you want to quantify that, you can say that my current density is some, whatever is the free carrier density here, times what is their velocity. So if we know these two things, we can find out how many carriers are crossing this cross section. Okay? And of course, each charge, if it has a carries a charge Q, this will be the current density. Okay? So again, two aspects, if you want to talk about current in any device, these are the two things you have to know and need to understand them. One is Q is of course just a constant, the charge carried by the charged particle. N is the number of mobile carriers. Okay? What is the number of mobile carriers in your device at any point? And actually, this is not a trivial question. This is a very deeper question. Why? Because you know, so the silicon atom has 14 electrons, right? You combine them together to make a silicon crystal. Now, each silicon atom has 14 electrons around it. Now, we ask the question in a device, how many of them can actually contribute to current? How many of them are free? And as it comes, this is not a very easy question. It's a very deep question. Okay? Because not all 14 actually do contribute. So which charges are mobile? Then how many mobile charges are there at any temperature? So these are all the questions we ask. And they are very deep questions. Okay? And then the second part is this velocity. Okay? So how fast these carriers move? What is their transport mechanism? Okay? Because you see, this is a transmission electron image from Intel, so about a few years back. So what is shown is, you all know FinFET devices, which are now in your mobile phones, laptops. So this is the fin of the FinFET, a little bit older generation. And you can see all silicon atoms nicely arranged in a crystalline fashion. And now what the question we are asking is, first, how many free carriers are there? And then second, what is the velocity they move in this complicated system? So this is not a trivial question, okay? Very deep questions. And to answer these two, actually you need to use quantum mechanics. That is fundamentally needed. But the results that come out of it, we can summarize in some basic things, which we will look at, okay? So first of all, to describe the behavior of electrons in a crystal like this, you need to use what's called electronic band structures. Okay, so all the information about how electron will behave in this is contained in that band structure. And how do you count mobile electrons in this? So there are these concepts of density of states and then the occupation of these states, something called Fermi-Dirac distribution. If you know these two concepts, you can move on by calculating that what is the carrier density in this. And then transport also, has many different aspects. So one transport is when you have don't have any scattering, it's a ballistic transport. Yeah. So if you know the band structure, actually you already are there. And then how to introduce scattering into it, and then what results. Yeah. So now let's look at the second part, which is the voltage. So say what we want to do is control the flow of say charged carrier, so say electrons. Okay. So suppose you are going on a road, okay? How do you control traffic flow? So traffic flow you can control by say putting barricades or having speed breakers. Okay. Why are they used? Why do they work? Because we, our scooters, our cars, they all have mass. Okay. And if you have something that goes up and down, it changes the potential energy as we go across it. Okay. So it affects us because we have mass and we have because of gravity. Okay. So we have to do some work to go over them. So we are creating a force on a car, on a scooter, on ourselves. Now we want to, what we want to do is actually do the same thing with electrons. Now electrons have a very small mass. So you can't do much with that, the gravity force. But electrons do have charge. And the electrostatic forces are much, much stronger than gravity. So what we do is that we use that force on that charge to create the potential landscape for the electron. So let me give you an example. So you are familiar with this. So this is Coulomb's law. Okay. So you have a charge capital Q, and you have some test charge Q. So it can be an electron. So you know what is the force between them? It is something like this. And you can calculate what is the potential energy of this system. Okay. So suppose this Q were a negative charge, say an electron, and this capital Q is the positive charge, your potential energy will come out to be something like this. Okay. If you plot this potential energy as a function of R, you get a curve like this. So this is a positive charge at the origin. And you have an electron that you bring from very large distance, and the potential energy of this positive and negative charge system looks like this. Okay. Now, this is the potential energy landscape for that electron. Because very intuitively, you can say that if I leave an electron here, it will try to go down the hill. It will try to reduce its potential energy. Okay. So because this is an attractive force. On the other hand, suppose this Q were a positive charge, okay, then in the potential energy term, you will get a plus sign. And you can make again this potential energy diagram. Now, very clearly, you see that if I have an electron here, a hole here now, a positive charge, we are talking about a positive test charge. If it tries to come a near positive charge, what it sees is this huge mountain of potential energy. Very similar to like we see, a potential barrier, a speed breaker or something like that. So an electron would have to have a lot of energy to actually come near to it. Otherwise, it cannot. Okay. So these are the kind of ideas we use to actually change the potential landscape which an electron sees, and then either make it easier for it to travel, transport, or make it harder for it. If you don't want to go it somewhere, we build a mountain like this. If we want the electrons to go in some direction, we make a downhill, like something like this. Okay? So essential ideas are these. But of course, we don't are working with not one or two charges, but in semiconductors, we have like large number of charges. So what we work with are charge densities, and we work with the equivalent formulation. Instead of Coulomb's law, we work with Gauss law. Okay? So where we have divergence of V is rho by epsilon, where rho is the total net charge density. Okay? And so essentially, you can start from this equation. Okay? If you know the net charge density, you can integrate it once, find the electric field, and you can integrate it another time, and you can get the potential. And you can get the potential landscape for your device. So we'll take a few examples and look at this. Okay. So this is the third aspect, which is very important in devices, is what is the electrostatics? What is the potential energy landscape which my charge carrier sees? Okay. So just to summarize, so how to describe and understand current flow in solids? So these are the three important things we always have to ask. One is what is the mobile carrier concentration? Okay, everywhere. The second is electrostatics, so solving for these potential landscapes which the electron sees. And the third part is, how does the transport happen? Does it ballistic, whether they are scattering, what kind of scattering, all these kind of questions.
So,
we're okay? So now let's start one by one into looking at each of these three aspects and then take some examples. So first question is, what is the mobile carrier concentration in my solid? Okay. So now let's again start to look at what we understand. So this is a simple atom. Okay. So atom, you know, has a positive nucleus and then electrons occupying the orbitals around it. Now, how do we understand this? So, of course, quantum mechanically, you know that this system will allow only discrete energy states. Okay? So, something like this. So, very discrete energy states. And we call these orbitals 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, into which the electrons can go. Okay? Now, what happens when you bring these atoms together? Okay? They can exchange electrons. Some electrons can get exchanged between the adjacent atoms, so they can get shared or they can get completely exchanged, and you can form crystals. Yeah. Now, and what happens to these energy levels? Each of these energy levels actually spreads into bands. Yeah. So this jump I won't talk much about. But you will hear more on Wednesday. So there is a talk on atomistic simulations by Professor Bomek. So you'll know a little bit more there. But what is important is, so these energy levels actually convert into bands, okay? And we get a band structure for a given solid. And all we have to do is start from this point onwards. So if there is a solid you are interested in, okay, you can find out its band structure. So there are a lot of people who do these band structure calculations. So if you go on literature, you go on Google band structure of this material, you will find it. So a lot of people have done calculations. Now, what information is in there and how to extract it? So that is our important point. Okay. So this is the band structure. Right now it's for silicon, but assume this is some random band structure. Okay. So the first question one can ask is, okay, so all materials actually start with individual atoms and then go to crystals. But then some materials are metal while some materials are insulators. Why is that? So what happens is, just like in any atom, you have electrons filled till some level, okay, you can start filling the bands in a band structure. So all of these bands actually have a lot of discrete states in them, which are very close to each other. Okay? So you can start filling them. And say at low temperatures, you can fill to certain level and ask the question that my topmost filled energy at that point, are there energy states or are there no energy states? For example, you can fill to this level. Let's say this is the topmost level. Now you can see there are states right above it. So if a solid is like this, it will behave like a metal. On the other hand, suppose if you keep filling and your final energy level is somewhere here where you get it, you till which you fill it, there are no energy states around it. This such a material will behave like an insulator, yeah, or a semiconductor. They're essentially the same thing. If you can dope it, it becomes a semiconductor. So in this case, so again, some terminology we use is the topmost filled band, we'll call valence band. Then there is a gap in which there are no energy states. And then there is the first unfilled band, which we call the conduction band. The energy spacing between the conduction band minima and the valence band maxima is what the band gap of the material. Carrier velocity information, what I was mentioning, is actually also there in the band structure. If an electron occupies any particular state, any of the states you take. So say the state, what is its velocity? So its velocity is actually given by the slope, local slope of the band. So 1 by h bar dE by dt. Okay. So that is given by locally. So if you are doing ballistic kind of transport, all you can do is you can just start from that point of view. That my electron is sitting at a certain state, it has a certain velocity. So if there is no scattering happen, it can actually just move with that velocity and contribute to currents.
So this is the first aspect.
Okay. So this is the band structure. Now how it is occupied, to talk about that. So this band structure has states. Now whether they are occupied or unoccupied, that is, we know by another concept that's called occupation function. So for electrons, okay, so electrons have spin half and they follow what's called a Fermi-Dirac distribution. So this you all know. So the distribution looks something like this. So what this is telling is, if I have a state with energy E, so this is my band structure. Okay. So I have a state with certain energy E. What is the probability of occupation of that state? And we express everything in terms of a parameter. That's this mu, okay? Sometimes denoted by EF. So either you call Fermi level or chemical potential. So essentially what it's saying is, so this is the distribution 1 divided by exponential E minus mu by KT. K here is Boltzmann constant. T is your temperature, absolute scale, plus 1. Okay. So how does the behavior look? Let's look at first. So suppose at very low temperature. So I took some example here. So say 3 Kelvin. Okay. I chose this parameter mu at E equals 1 electron volt, just to show you how the function varies. And if I plot this function, what I get is this line, square kind of a shape. Okay. So what this is saying, if I have an energy level which is less than this 1 eV Fermi level, it will be filled. If it is above it, the probability of occupation is almost zero. Okay, so I still took 3 Kelvin, not 0 Kelvin. At 0 Kelvin, it will be absolutely zero. So it will be empty. Okay. So again, so in this case, so if your Fermi level is somewhere in between in this band gap, all these states are filled and all these states above it are empty. Okay. Now what happens at finite temperatures? So if you increase the temperature, the Fermi-Dirac distribution looks now something like this. Again, I have kept the parameter mu or the Fermi level again at 1 eV. Now something interesting is there. If you go far below the Fermi level, okay, of course, the Fermi-Dirac distribution value is still 1. That means if you go far below the Fermi level, these states will still be for sure filled, almost filled. Okay. But as you approach the Fermi level, very near to it, you see that the Fermi-Dirac distribution value falls. So even below it, there is a probability that some of the states will be empty. They will not be filled. Okay. So it's not one. And also some states above it, okay, earlier at low temperatures, this went to zero almost. But now at finite temperatures, or especially closer to room temperature, okay, so you can see that there is a finite probability of occupation for these states. So actually these states which were completely empty at low temperatures now can have some electrons. Okay. Many times we will not work with this full Fermi-Dirac distribution, but a simpler version. Okay. What's called Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. So this is this other curve, the blue curve I have drawn. Okay. So as you can see, so KT, you know, at room temperature is typically like 25 MeV, 26 MeV kind of a number. So if my energy E is larger by the chemical potential by few KT, right, 3 KT, 4 KT, something like that. So here you can see, if my energy is larger by 3 KT or 4 KT, I cannot distinguish between Maxwell-Boltzmann and the Fermi-Dirac distribution. So for all calculation purposes, you can just as well use this. But the condition is that your energy level should be above 3 kT or 4 kT above your Fermi level. Otherwise, there is error. This is the true reality. This is an approximation, which is a very good one if your energy are about 3 kT or 4 kT above your Fermi levels. Okay. Other things. Now at finite temperatures, okay, so we know that some electrons from less than EF are missing and they are present in states which are more than EF. What this corresponds to in a semiconductor picture is that some of the electrons which are occupying the valence band, they get excited and go into the conduction band. So you have some electrons now in the conduction band and you have some empty states in the valence band. These empty states can itself act like charge carriers, positively charged carriers now. So this is very similar to, you have seen this game of musical chairs, right? So say you have 20 chairs, but one chair is empty. Okay? You start the music, everybody starts running, and then they sit. Okay? What you say effectively is that moving chair has moved to a different position, as if the moving chair has its life of its own. So this is what happens. So you can either work with a lot of electrons that are filling this band, or you can work with very few empty states that are at the top. So what we choose is choose work with those few empty states. Just like in the case of a musical chair, you can follow up that one empty chair that is moving around in the game. Okay. So there are these two particles that ultimately contribute to current. So we have electrons in the conduction band, and in the valence band, we will talk in terms of the empty states, which are holes. I have still not told you how to find this parameter mu. Okay, I just chose some values. So as long as you find, if you know EF, you know everything. But we don't know what EF is right now. We will come to that in few slides. Okay. Now, there is a very powerful approximation in which we work almost always. So most of people won't work with the full band structure. Okay. Many devices you can actually work out with what's called an effective mass approximation. And what is that? So see, as you saw, say you have a semiconductor like this. At finite temperatures, your Fermi level lies somewhere in this band gap. We don't know exactly where, somewhere in this band gap. And you know that how does the occupation probability of these states change with energy? Actually, it decreases exponentially. So if you have a state far above here, so see the scale here, it goes from 0 to 6 electron volt. But if even if you change by few kT, so let's say 100 MeV, 200 MeV, already the occupation probability of these states has exponentially decreased. So in all probability, these top states are all empty, almost empty. Okay. So they might have few electrons, but then of course, when you have a lot of electrons somewhere, you will count them. Okay. Because all you are interested in is how many electrons cross with a certain velocity. So actually, most of the electrons are in this lower part. Okay. This is where there is a finite probability. Similarly, if you look in the valence band, most of the empty states are actually not far below it. It's actually very near to it. Okay. So most of the times we are not interested in the full band structure. What we are interested in is how my electron or a hole behaves when it is occupying this lowest part of the conduction band or the topmost part of the valence band. So if we can represent those shapes reliably, for most devices, we might not have to worry about the full band structure. And this is what an effective mass approximation is. Okay. So an effective mass approximation, okay, so the blue curve might be a more realistic band, but because we are interested only in the lowest portion of the band, what we do is you can fit a parabola to it. Okay. And as you can see, this is a very good fit till some energy level, and beyond which the fit becomes pretty bad. Okay. But if your electrons are not occupying those higher energy states, you don't care. Okay. because my electron is mostly occupying this lower energy state, my parabola is a very good fit, and let me work with the parabola and not work with this more complicated band structure. So this is what an effective mass approximation is. So this fit has only one parameter in it, which is this. So for a free electron, so if you have a completely free electron, okay, free means there is no potential variation on it. So its kinetic energy is half mv square, right? You can write that as p square by 2m also. Or in quantum mechanics, p is actually same as h bar k. So for a free electron, this is how its ek relation comes about. E is h square k square by 2m, where m will be the normal mass, 9.1 10 power minus 31 kg. If you do in a semiconductor this fitting business, you can write this equation of this fit as something like this, E minus the minima EC as h square k square by m star. This is the parabola, k square. So the curvature you have to use, that gives you what's now called an effective mass. Okay. So what this is saying is, even though you have so many atoms in your crystal, if your device, if your electrons don't have a lot of energy, they don't occupy these higher energy states, for all practical purposes, you can forget about all the atoms. They don't affect your behavior at all. Your electron behaves just like a free electron. All those atoms do is change its mass from, say, 9.1 10 power minus 31 to something else. So a fraction of it, or more than that, either. So this is the only change that happens. Same thing you can do in the valence band. And again, get an effective mass. Okay. So this is a very big jump. What we are saying is we completely forget about the band structure. As long as my electrons don't occupy these higher energy states, I'll work with my masses. But mass has this information embedded in the band structure information. So these are some typical masses. You know, silicon has mass of 0.26, 0.39. So in this case, you can see this is where the silicon minima is. Okay. So the effective mass here, if you do a calculation, will come out to be 0.26. It's actually a little bit more involved because silicon has different masses in different directions. Okay. But this is the basic idea for any general semiconductor. Okay, now let me come to this concept of density of states, because this is what we will mostly work with. So as I told, that what you see as continuous lines in the band structure actually are not so. There are a lot of states very close to each other on this line. But they're so close to each other that it looks like a continuous line. But they are finite. Okay? So if you count, it's a finite number of states. And we quantize this, okay? So we express it as a number by this concept of density of states. Okay? So what this essentially says is, so if I have energy range from E to E plus BE, some delta E kind of energy range, how many states are there? Okay? So what is dN by dE? So this I'm again giving you the result directly, but one can do it. If you have a band structure which looks like a parabola, right, which in effective mass approximation is true for us, if your band structure looks like this, h square k square by 2m, at any energy E, what is the density of states? These are the results depending on the dimension of the system. So like bulk silicon or any other bulk material, if my electron is free to move in all three directions, x, y, z, the density of states looks something like this. Yeah. So it is actually goes as square root of E. So higher is the energy. So higher is the electron in that band. Yeah. So higher is the electron in this band, higher is the density of states. The number of states that are available. On the other hand, if you go in a two-dimensional system, so two-dimensional system is electron to move in two directions but cannot move in third. An example would be a MOSFET inversion layer. In a MOSFET inversion layer, my electron can move anywhere in the plane, but cannot go up or down. Because on one side there is oxide, the other side there is a silicon barrier, depletion layer barrier. Okay? So it can move in XY direction. In such a case, the density of states actually is different because my electrons is not free to move. And again, if you have a band like this, parabolic, but now of course K will have two components, Kx square and Ky square. The density of states looks something like this. It's actually independent of energy. It is given by m by pi h bar square, and it is independent of energy. No matter where you are in that parabola, it is same density of states, same amount of states as if you take a given dE variation. So say 50 MeV, you take 50 MeV at 0.5 eV, does not matter. If you take at 1 eV, does not matter. Of course, as long as this parabolic approximation is valid, as long as you don't go in this regime, as long as you are in the good fit regime. Okay. And then there are systems 1D, like a nanowire, in which my electron is free to move only along one direction. It cannot go in other directions. The density of states looks completely different, and it looks more like 1 by square root of E. Okay. So it peaks very close to the conduction band and then falls very sharply. Okay. So very different behaviors, and these are very relevant. So as you can see, this you already see in a MOSFET. And as we are scaling the devices more and more, we are going into lower dimensions. So all that, one important thing that is changing is of course the band structure, but what is also changing is the density of states that are available. Now we are equipped to handle that question that how many carriers are there in the our semiconductor. So how you calculate the carrier density is, so this is say the equilibrium carrier density in your system in the conduction band. This is the density of states. So right now I'm doing for 3D. You can do for 2D or 1D. It's the same kind of a formula. So this is the density of states. And this is the Fermi-Dirac distribution. So this tells you how many states are there. And this tells you whether they are filled or they are unfilled. So if you multiply them together, you get how many filled states you have there. Okay. And you essentially integrate this from the bottom of the conduction band to the top. This formula is valid irrespective of whether you have a parabolic band, linear band, anything. This is a very general formula. Okay. All that will change with the shape of the band structure is what is my density of states. The results I'm giving you are for parabolic. If you have more complicated bands, these results will change. Okay. But for most semiconductors, I think we can start with them. So this is the density of states, and then you have Fermi-Dirac distribution. Many times, so typically what we see in our first courses in semiconductors is a simplified version of this. If your Fermi level actually lies within the band gap, you know that Fermi-Dirac distribution we can simplify as a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Okay? If my energy states are say 3 kT or 4 kT above the Fermi level, in that case, you can perform this integration and you get a result like this. So it actually comes from this. Okay? So there is a pre-factor, what we call NC. Okay? So this is what's called effective density of states. So this is not the actual density of states. This is just effective density of states. And there is an exponential factor, ECB minus EF by KBT. So what this is saying is, as my EF goes lower and lower from the conduction band minima, number of electrons in the conduction band decreases exponentially, which makes sense because my occupation function is actually a decaying exponential. It's a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Similarly, one can do for holes. Now for holes, again, this is the same kind of integration, but now on top of the valence band. So again, you have a density of states, but now in the valence band density of states. Now for holes, what we are interested in is not the filled states, but the empty states. So the probability of that state being empty is 1 minus F, because F is the probability of being filled. So again, you can write it like this. And again, if your EF lies somewhere in the band gap and not within the bands, you can again make a Maxwell-Boltzmann approximation and you get something like this, that your total hole concentration is again a prefactor, which we call effective density of states for the valence band, times e to the power minus EF E valence band top by KBT. So again, similar kind of things, that if my Fermi level goes away from the valence band top edge, the number of empty states in the valence band actually drops exponentially, or my whole concentration drops exponentially. So with this, so this is the most general kind of formulation that holds for any band structure, anything, as long as, of course, you know the density of states. And this is more true for if you have parabolic bands, if you use this kind of a density of states, and if your Fermi level lies somewhere within the band gap, not within the bands. So this is approximated version, which holds for a lot of cases, but actually breaks down in some cases also, then you have to go back to something like this. Yes. It is actually. So yes, but that is already quantum. Why? Because if you find out the wavelength of the electron, so you know there is this dual nature of matter, right? So each electron actually has a wavelength associated with it. So if you take the typical energy of an electron, so say energy is kT, thermal energy, okay? Now you put that in the de Broglie wavelength equation, find out the wavelength. So you will typically get a value of close to 5-10 nanometer, something like that. So any potential structure or any potential landscape whose dimensions are comparable to this wavelength, the system, the electron will behave completely different. So, yes and no. So, there are the multiple parts. So, what happens is, when you quantize, so have you looked at this infinite well kind of a problem? Okay. So, see, as you quantize in one direction, you have these discrete states, right? Now, if you fill only one of these states, your density of states will be exactly like this. So say you have inverted the MOSFET, but you are occupying only the lowest quantized state, then actually it is a completely 2D system. Because see, electron, what 2D means is the electron is not allowed to go in the other two directions. And because the width, because of the wavelength factor, yeah, you have to quantize it. But then you also see that electron is actually not free to move in that direction. On one side, you have a big oxide on the gate side. And on the other side, you have this barrier of silicon depletion. Right? So you have this well kind of a triangular well kind of a structure. So my electron cannot go this way because there is a silicon oxide barrier. And it cannot go this way because there is a silicon depletion barrier. But from source to drain, it is free to move. So this is a two-dimensional system, which is free to move in two directions, but cannot move in the third direction. So that's why I'm calling it 2D. I'm not even talking about double gate. So see, let me talk about one by one. Okay. So say you have a normal planar MOSFET. Now a planar MOSFET has this planar gate on top of it. And then this is silicon. And then you have oxide in it. You apply the potential and say inverted the channel. Now what happens is these electrons that are in the inversion layer, they're free to move in this direction. But they cannot go up or they go down. So this is a two-dimensional system, because electrons are free to move only in two directions. Now, when you are in a double gate MOSFET, what you are doing is, you have a finite silicon thickness, right? You put another gate on the bottom, and another oxide also. Now, you apply a voltage and you invert that side also. So, So there is the inversion layer on the lower part, and then there is an inversion layer on the top part. And both of these are 2D systems. This moves in its own plane, this moves its own plane. Of course, when you, if you keep on decreasing the silicon thickness, they can start talking to each other. But they both independently are 2D systems.
A few nanometers, so yeah, 2-3 nanometers is a good number. Few nanometers. Typically depends on, see, when you are applying more and more gate bias, that triangular width is changing. So it depends on the bias you apply. Will be a cylindrical one, yes. If your nanowire width is quite large, then yes, it's a cylindrical. Okay. All right. So now we know how to calculate the carrier density in the conduction band and the hole density in the valence band. Now in this effective density of states, the mass that comes, okay. So if you have a very simple semiconductor in which there is just one conduction band and then one valence band, and you can find out its mass by the curvature. If there is such a simple semiconductor, then the mass that goes in this effective density of states is also the same. Same number. But actually for silicon, for germanium, the life is a little more complicated. The band structure actually has a lot of other things. For example, for silicon, this is one minima, but silicon has 5 more minimas like this in the other parts of the band structure, which are not shown here. Okay. And when you are counting, so see, what we are interested in is counting the total number of states. Okay. So ultimately, what we need is this total density of states. So you have to count all the states that are between E and E plus DE in that range. So for silicon, you have to count not only these, but those other 5 what are called valleys also, because they have the same energy. Okay. So because of that additional factor, the mass that goes in here is actually slightly different. It's what's called density of states effective mass. And yeah, for electrons comes out to be something like this for silicon. Okay. For silicon, for lateral transfer, but this is the density of states mass. For gallium arsenide, life is simple. For gallium arsenide, conduction band has only one band. So the mass you get from this kind of a calculation, same mass you use in the effective density of states calculation also. Okay. This is an additional kind of a complication. Same thing is true of these valence bands. So you can already see there are 2 bands here. Okay. Actually, there are 3. So this light hole, heavy hole split off. So there are 3 bands and all of them have states in them. So when you are doing this calculation of carrier density, when you're doing density of states calculation, you have to include states in each of these bands. Okay. So what number you use here is again has a band mass corresponding to the first band and then a band mass corresponding to the other band. And the net mass you have to use is what's called again a density of states mass, but now for the valence band. Okay. So this is a little bit more intricate thing because that comes from the band structure of that particular material. Okay. But the basic idea remains the same. If you know where your Fermi level is, this is how you can calculate the electron density in your conduction band, irrespective of material. So this I am doing 3D, but this is the general idea for any nanostructure. This is the general idea that you integrate in the conduction band. You have a factor for density of states, okay? And then you have a factor of occupation. Same for the valence band, but here you do 1 minus F because how many states are empty. Okay, so that's Now let's start doing some numbers.
So let's first start with intrinsic semiconductors, which don't have a doping.
Okay, so pure materials.
And we ask the question that what is the number of electrons or holes in this material? What are the number of free carriers? Okay, so how much current can I get out of that? So you know that this we already just found that if we have parabolic bands, this is my free electron concentration and this is my free hole concentration. Now, if it's an intrinsic material, all that happens is some of the electrons from the valence band get excited to the conduction band. So this is obvious that the number of electrons in the conduction band will be same as the number of empty states in the valence band, because those are the electrons that actually got excited. Okay. So if that is true, so this is the my electron and hole concentration, but they are equal. This is the condition. So either you can call it charge neutrality, that positive charge is same as negative charge, or you can say that those are the electrons that actually got excited to the conduction band. So if you put them together, the only unknown in this equation is that parameter you were interested in, which is the Fermi level. This is the one thing we didn't know. So if you put them together, you can solve for the Fermi level. And what you get is an expression something like this, that your Fermi level for intrinsic semiconductor at any temperature is something like this. So it's Eg by 2 minus 3 by 4 kT. This. So if you have same masses for the conduction band and valence band, this term will be zero and your Fermi level will be actually exactly at the mid gap. But if that is not so, then there is a temperature dependent term. So depending on the masses, your Fermi level might move one way or the other. Now, once you know the Fermi level, you can put this back and get either Ni or Pi. They're both equal. So you can just calculate one of them and you get an expression something like this. That the intrinsic carrier density goes as square root NcNv exponential minus Eg by 2kT. So larger is the gap, lower is the intrinsic carrier density, higher is the temperature, higher is the intrinsic carrier density. So I have just plotted this for few typical semiconductors. Germanium has a band gap of about 0.7-ish kind of electron volt. And you get a number at room temperature, about 2.5 10 power 13 per centimeter cube. Silicon has 1.5 10 power 10 per centimeter cube, little bit larger band gap, 1.1 eV. Gallium arsenide has even larger band gap, so 1.4 electron volt, 1.43 electron voltish or so. And the carrier density is even lower, 2 into 10 power 6 per centimeter cube. Okay. So as you can guess from these numbers, the typical number of atoms in materials are like Avogadro number, right? 10 power 22, 10 power 23 per centimeter cube. These numbers are terribly low. So if you just work with intrinsic kind of carrier concentrations, you won't get much current in your devices because these numbers are very, very low. So we have to now do some engineering to raise these numbers, have more free carriers in my system. And this is what we do by what's called doping. So now what we do is put some different materials or atoms into my semiconductor system, which has either excess electrons or less electrons. So there are these two types of doping. So what you can do is say this is silicon crystal, and you replace one silicon atom with a group 5 element. Group 5 is right next to silicon but has one extra electron. So like arsenic, which has 5 electrons in its valence shell, so it can satisfy all the bondings of silicon, which is 4 electrons, but then it still has an extra electron. And this extra electron can now go to the conduction band and contribute to conduction. Similarly, what you can do is replace one silicon atom with a group 3 element. So for example, a boron element. And because this has one less electron, what it can do is it can take one electron from the valence band and leave an empty space in the valence band. Now this empty space or empty state
can lead to conduction and what's what called a hole. So now we have this way of controlling the amount of free current. In this case, we don't have a control. It's decided by EG, by effective masses and temperature. We don't have much of a control over there. But now we have a control. By controlling the amount of these impurities, we can control how much electrons or holes there should be in the system. So again, depending on the application I'm working with, I need some amount of current. How many carriers do I need? Something like that. Okay. All right. And then actually what happens as you put these atoms is they lead to an energy level within the band gap. Okay. So at very low temperatures, the electrons that are, say, for this case with arsenic, the extra electron, that does not have enough energy to go to EC or to the conduction band. But as you increase temperatures, these electrons have enough energy and then they can go to conduction band and contribute to conduction. So if you look at what is the free carrier density as a function of temperature, so what is plotted here is actually 1000 by T, inverse T. So temperature increases as you go in this direction. Okay. So this is a material, but it's a very typical graph. So this is silicon doped with 10 power 15 donors per centimeter cube. And the curve you get, so at very low temperatures, if you go somewhere over here, what happens is the electrons don't, which are occupying this donor state, don't have enough energy to go into the conduction band. And they don't go into the conduction band, they don't become free electrons. They don't contribute to that number. So the amount of free electrons in your system is actually very small. As you increase the temperature by going this way, now more and more of these electrons in that donor state excite to the conduction band. Okay? And now you have number of electrons is same as the number of donor atoms you have put into the system, and you have a lot of free carriers. Okay, so this is the extrinsic regime. Now, if you keep on increasing the temperature, okay, there is a parallel process that is happening that more of the electrons in the valence band are getting excited to the conduction band just because of the temperature. This we already did the calculation. At some point, this number, if your temperature is high enough, can overcome this number which you have doped. And then your material behaves just like an intrinsic semiconductor with equal number of electrons and holes. Okay? So this is the engineering we have. Now, how do we actually, so again, see that question still comes. Yes. What is the? Yes. Because beyond certain temperature, so say in this case, you put 10 to the power 15 donor atoms per centimeter cube. So beyond certain temperature, all of the electrons which were with these donor atoms, they all excited and went to the conduction band. Because there were 10 to the 15 of them here, all of the electrons went to the conduction band. Now, if you increase temperature, there are no more electrons coming from them because all of them have given the electrons. And the electrons that are coming from the valence band are still very low in number. So this remains flat. If you increase the temperature further, then that intrinsic concentration overcomes this. And then you have again an increase in the concentrations. Okay. Now that question again comes to, again, fully understand this system and find out the carrier densities, something like this kind of a calculation if you want to do. Question comes, where is my Fermi level? Where is that reference? Because to do that integral, that is one parameter we have to find out. So in cases such as this, you can find out your Fermi level again by applying a similar principle, charge neutrality. So charge neutrality is that total positive charge is same as the total negative charge in the system. So in this case, the positive charge can come from holes, from ionized donors, which leave one electron and get positively charged, from electrons and negatively charged acceptor ions. So this is the total positive charge. This is the total negative charge. So if you take an example like this, okay, then this example, It has been doped N-type, only with 10 power 15 donor atoms. So of course, you don't have acceptor atoms in this case. So you can forget about this term. There is no acceptor atoms, so there is no acceptor ions also. So your equation becomes something like this. Now, P you can write in form, if you know Fermi level, you can write P in terms of Fermi level. Okay? And also you can write in terms of Fermi level. And similarly, ND plus actually you can write in terms of Fermi level if you know what is the donor activation energy. So the only unknown in this equation is Fermi level. You find that out and then you put back and find out what is P, N, ND plus whatever at any temperature. So this is the iteration circle that goes. All right. So that's pretty much it in this. So see, the power of semiconductors is this. So there are these materials which are metals, which are very good conductors. So their resistivity is extremely low, 10 power minus 6 ohm centimeter. And then on the other hand, we have insulators whose resistivity is extremely high, 10 power 14. So you see, this is 20 orders. Now, semiconductors are essentially insulators. They have a band gap, but we have figured out how to dope them, how to change the carrier concentration in them. So a lot of the materials which used to be considered perfect insulators. So an example would be aluminum nitride, because the band gap is 6 eV. Now we consider it as a semiconductor because people have figured out how to dope it. We make devices with it. Essentially, all insulators are potential semiconductors, but in a semiconductor, we develop the capability to dope it and change its behavior all the way from insulator to metal. So this is an example of silicon in which doping density has been changed from 10 power 12 to 10 power 21 per centimeter cube, and its resistivity goes from 10 power minus 4 to 10 power plus 4, 8 orders. So this is the real power that you can change the conductivity of the material on demand, whatever your requirement wants. Okay. So this is the real power. Now here are some terms. So some good order of magnitudes to always keep in mind. See this NCNV, effective density of states number. So this is the expression. So these are the typical numbers for some semiconductors. So for silicon, NC is about 2.8 10 power 19, NV is 1.4 10 power 19. Again, 10 power 19 per centimeter cube. This is roughly kind of a number. And you will hear these terms again and again, N minus, P minus, NP, N plus, P plus. Okay? So what this means is, so these are different kind of doping regimes. If you dope very low compared to NCNV, like 10 power 15, 10 power 14, we typically call it N minus P minus. It's just a notation. So nothing deeper about it. Little bit higher, but still less than that, might call NP. Okay. In this whole regime, your Fermi-Dirac to Maxwell-Boltzmann approximation works because your Fermi level stays within the band gap. Okay. But as soon as you cross or approach this NCNV value, you call it N plus, P plus material. Your Fermi level actually enters or approaches very close to your conduction band and valence band's edge. Now your Boltzmann approximation is no longer valid. You have to go back to Fermi Dirac. Okay. But many times in devices, we have like this, so you can keep on using Boltzmann, but always keep this caveat in mind that if you have very, very heavy dopings, that Maxwell-Boltzmann approximation is not valid and you have to go back to Fermi Dirac. All right. So these are just some things you should be aware of. So a lot of things going on, right? So this is the traditional bulk doping, which was introduced way, way before. That how do you get controlled carrier concentration in the system? You do by doping, just like we discussed. But later people developed these techniques called modulation doping. So this is about in 80s. Yeah, so molecular beam epitaxy, this technique was developed. And the idea was, as you dope it, you are actually making the material bad because you're putting this material in. So say you are doping by arsenic atom, it donates one electron or it has a positive charge. Now I have extra free electron. When it tries to move through my semiconductor, it gets scattered by this positive charge. So I cannot get very high conductivities.
my mobility or essentially my electron cannot move. Because of this positive charge, it gets scattered. So if you want more electrons, you put a lot of these arsenic atoms, but now you have more scattering. Okay? How to avoid that? So people develop this technique called modulation doping, in which they will have a heterostructure, something like this. So maybe aluminum gallium arsenide, it was first demonstrated, but it has been demonstrated in many systems now. So you dope one material, it donates the electrons and they go to the other material. Now you have spatially separated them. Your electrons are in one material and your donor atoms, which gave that electrons, in a different material. So you have spatially separated them. So these electrons can now move and not see much of these scatterers. So you can get very high mobilities. I'll show some numbers later. You get very, very high mobilities in this system. Yes, so see, you typically dope maybe about 10 power 18, 10 power 20 here or so. Sure, sure, true. So you choose typically systems which are very nicely lattice matched. So like gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide system is very nicely lattice matched. So you can grow films without any dislocations. Yeah, that is right. Okay, then this idea came in late 90s, what's called polarization induced doping. So you know gallium nitride. In gallium nitride, actually you don't put any donor atoms. You just make a heterostructure of aluminum nitride with gallium nitride and you have electrons, okay? As if you have put a dopant, but you don't put any dopants. What happens in that material is they have a property called polarization. Okay? So their crystal structure is such that each unit cell has a dipole in there. When you put a heterostructure of, say, gallium nitride and aluminum nitride, at the interface, because of the polarization difference of two materials, you get a fixed charge. And that fixed charge induces electrons, free electrons into gallium nitride. Okay? So because of polarization, these free electrons come. So this is what's called polarization-induced doping. It's much more recent kind of thing. And then, of course, there are dynamic methods of inducing carriers, removing them. Like in a MOSFET, you have a gate, you put voltages more than threshold voltage, you have carriers, you remove it, carriers go away. Right? So this is a dynamic way in which you can move the Fermi level up and down and have different amount of carriers depending on how you want the device to behave. Do you want it to behave like a switch which is open, or do you want to behave it like a switch which is closed? So this is in your hand. And then, of course, there's optical excitation. You can shine light on it with energies more than the band gap. You can have electron hole pairs excited, and you can do some more things. So this is the first part. Okay. So you now know how to calculate the number of free carriers in the system. Now we go to the second part, is how to calculate the potential landscape they see. So here we introduce this concept of band diagrams. You are familiar with. So this is Professor Herb Kroemer from Santa Barbara. So he got a Nobel Prize in, I think, 2001 or so. He has this statement that if in discussing a semiconductor problem, you cannot draw an energy band diagram. So this potential landscape, this shows that you don't know what you're talking about. So this is a very important aspect of understanding semiconductor devices. That how does the potential landscape look for it? And then he has this corollary that if you can draw one but you don't, then your audience won't know what you're talking about. Yeah. So very important aspects. So now what are band diagrams? See, band diagrams are essentially, you have this conduction band edge and you have a valence band edge. How do they change as you go spatially from one end of the device to the other end of the device? That is essentially the band diagram. How does that conduction band edge go up and down as you go across the device? That is a band diagram. How do you get to that? So this I introduced a little bit earlier. Okay? So you have Gauss law. Everything starts from there. You have a certain charge density distribution in your device. If you know that, so in this case, this will be your net charge. What is the local hole concentration? What is the local ionized acceptor density? What is the local electron concentration?
what is the local acceptor, ionized acceptor concentration. Okay? So if you know all that at each point, this is your net charge density in the system. You put in your Gauss law. You do one integration. You find out what is the field. You do one more integration. You find out what is the potential. Okay. And if you do that, what you can find is, if you know the potential, you can find out how my conduction band changes as a function of position. That is just minus E times this potential. And you can find out how the valence band changes, because the difference between the conduction band and valence band is the band gap. Okay. So very simple kind of algorithm. So if you know the charge density, you integrate it, get field, you integrate it, get potential, and from that find out how my EC and EV change as a function of space. And locally, if you know EC, EV, you can always differentiate them and find out the field. So slope of a band at any point, this is band diagram, not band structure, that will give you the local electric field. So let me take some examples. Suppose what you have is a sheet charge, something like this. So positive sheet charge with the density of sigma, so coulomb per centimeter square. So if I draw, this is my charge. This is a charge as a function of space. It is localized at some point, say origin. Now for this simple one, you know the answer. What is the field on this side? What is on this side? You can integrate the Gauss law. And you know that the field is actually sigma by 2 epsilon s. This way, going outward from the sheet. Okay. So if you draw the field diagram after this integration, so you know what is the charge, you integrate it, and you will get a field like this. A constant field, sigma by 2 epsilon s in positive x, and a negative sigma by 2 epsilon s, and there is a huge jump as you cross the sheet charge. You can do another integration of this and find out the potential. For a constant term, if you integrate, you will get a linear term with a space, right? So the electric potential, if you integrate in this case, comes out like this. Now, if you know the potential, it's easy to go to band diagram, right? You multiply with minus E, that gives you the EC variation, and then you know EG, so you can find out the EV variation. So your band diagram in this case looks like this. Now, that intuitive aspect, see, what is happening here is a positive sheet charge is sitting at the origin. Now, very intuitively, you can see that if I leave an electron here, it will fall down the well. Okay, this is very intuitive. And you know that is what will happen here, because there is a positive sheet charge, my electron will get attracted to it. So all these kind of very intuitive aspects actually become clear when you make a band diagram for a given charge distribution or in a given device. So it's very important to draw them. And this is the general algorithm. So if you can do this, so let me show you some typical ones you will encounter in devices. Yeah. So this is for a free electron. You don't have any charge and you have flat bands. Electron can go smoothly. Okay, if it has a velocity, it can go smoothly. Nothing to stop it. If you have a positive slab charge like this, your field will become like this. So outside the slab, it will look like a sheet charge, sigma by 2 epsilon kind of a field. Within that, this will change linearly. So you can go home and try to integrate this slab charge and get all these results. Okay. And then when you integrate, what you get is you will have this parabolic behavior within this, and outside it's more linear behavior. Similarly, you can do for a negative slab charge. For positive, we did. It looks like this. For negative, it looks like this. And again, this is a dipole charge. You have a positive charge and a negative charge. That will give rise to zero fields either way and a uniform field between them. So now the field has this profile. And now when you integrate this, this is how the band diagrams look. So you can go over and then just quickly get a feel for this. Okay. So you can always remember. So there are a few things you can very quickly remember. See, this looks like this is a positive, right? So positive energy, positive charge, you smile. So it gives you a smiley face. If you have a negative charge, it gives you a frowny face. So you can very quickly remember this. So if you have a positive charge, typically you will get upward sloped curvatures in Venn diagram. And if you have a negative, it will give you a downward sloped one. And you can very quickly get the shape of the Venn diagram for any device. Okay. This is a tool if you are interested. So this is a free tool. It's a 1D Poisson. You can freely download it from this. It's Professor Greg Snyder from my grad school. He wrote this tool when he was a PhD student. And it's a very good tool for one-dimensional analysis, and it can solve the Schrödinger equation and the Poisson equation self-consistently. So it can give you the band diagrams, electron densities, wave functions, all those things, but for 1D. All right. Now, so another adage by Professor Kroma. So he said, interface is the device. This is very true. All interesting behavior actually does not, mostly happens at interfaces of two things. So as Amit was mentioning earlier, now the interface is, say, fundamental physics and electrical engineering. Okay, so this is another example. So when they interfere, interesting exchange happens. And it is very true in devices. Interesting things happen when you bring two materials which have a different properties together. One example would be a p-type semiconductor and an n-type semiconductor. There you have charge transfer and then you get a diode. Okay. Or you can have something like this, aluminum gallium arsenide, which has different band gaps. Now you can dope it, make it modulation doping, just like we were discussing, and you can get very high mobilities in that. You can have a metal and a semiconductor, and then again, depending on their work functions, you can get either a Schottky diode or a very good ohmic contact. Yeah. So a lot of interesting things happen when you bring two things together. So a lot of interesting behaviors happen. Okay. Let me give a very quick example. Yeah. I think we have some time, but I think I need to hurry now. So see, some parameters one should know about the device. Of course, if you have a metal, there is one parameter one needs to know to draw a band diagram, which is its work function. So if EF is like the topmost energy level at low temperatures for a metal, how much energy does it cost to take an electron from the Fermi level and make it free? So that is the work function. Now in semiconductors, there are a few more one has to know. So this is the vacuum level. This is EC, conduction band edge minima, and this is valence band maxima. So, and then there is a Fermi level, which you can tune by doping or other means. So again, work function is the difference between the Fermi level and the vacuum level. There is electron affinity, that is from EC to vacuum level. And then EI is just, you add EG to it. Yeah. So if you know two, you know, I think if you know the band gap, that's enough. So typically what happens when you bring two materials, so this I'm just giving for example, need not be metal or any two materials together. What happens is, typically they will have different Fermi levels. So when you bring them together, okay, so just like if you have two buckets with different water levels and you connect them by a pipe, water will flow from one to the other till you have same water levels. Okay. Very similar kind of thing happens here. That electrons or mobile carriers will get exchanged between the two systems once you bring them in contact, so that there is a uniform Fermi level. But it has a consequence. Initially, each semiconductor was charge neutral. It had equal number of electrons as the positive charge. But now it loses some electrons or gains some electrons from the other system that came. So each part now has a net charge. This net charge, as you know from Gauss law, leads to band bending. And now you can have barriers and a more complicated energy landscape for your carriers. Okay. That's why you get interesting device behavior. So let's look at one example. Okay. So this is a PN interface. Okay. So you have a P-type semiconductor, N-type semiconductor. You bring them together. Okay. So this is how a Fermi level will look for an N-type semiconductor and for a P-type semiconductor. So this is an unequilibrium state. When you bring them together, you know, the electrons will move from this system to this system. Okay.
Again, equilibration, and you will get something. So you will get, once these electrons leave, this system which was charge neutral earlier now will have a net positive charge because electrons are going away. This which was charge neutral now will have a negative charge because it is accepting electrons. Okay? So this will have a negative charge, this will have a positive charge. A very quick band diagram you can draw, negative curvature, positive curvature comes down. And your band EF is completely flat. What is the exact shape of this? For this, that you need to know what is the exact shape of the charge densities there. Yeah. And what is, so what happens once this exchange happens? Now you have a more complicated band diagram for this. Yeah. In which there is a built-in potential. And built-in potential essentially is always the difference of Fermi levels of the systems you bring together. You can do it a little more precisely. And what happens is, the positive charge you get on this side is something like this. The negative charge you get is, so this, see, there are only two components of charge that can be there in this system. This is an n-type semiconductor. Yeah? So the positive charge in this system is Nd plus, positively ion donors. And then the negative part is the electron concentration. So the net charge in the system is Nd plus minus N. Now, as this system loses electrons, very near to this, the electron concentration actually drops exponentially. So this you can see from this very base band diagram. So you know, the separation of EC and EV, EC and EF gives you the N0 concentration that we derived earlier, right? So it's NC times exponential difference of these two levels. So as this energy separation changes, my electron concentration drops exponentially with the separation. So if this drops exponentially, after very short distance, N is negligible compared to Nd plus. So in the bulk, far away from the interface, they balance each other. N is same as Nd plus. It's charge neutral. But as you approach the interface, the free electrons all go away. And the net carrier net charge density comes out something like this, slab charge. So now this is a slab charge. So now you know how to exactly do this. You do one integration, you get a linear field. You do another integration, you get a parabolic potential. Same thing happens on this side. So you get a field like this, and finally bands something like this. Okay. This is one additional thing to worry about, is many times when we solve this problem, analytically, if you want to do it, we use what's called a depletion approximation. We assume that this is a very nice step edge, but in real materials, it can never be. Okay. So there's something called screening. So this is always a gradual step. So for example, you do it in depletion approximation with pen paper, you will get a nice step edge. You go to 1D Poisson and solve it, you will get something like I have drawn, a more smoother curve. So what is the typical width of this smooth region? That's what's given by Debye length. Yes, this is a screening length. So this depends on how much free carriers you have in the system. If you have lots and lots of free carriers, screening can happen very quickly. Your Debye lengths are very small. If you have very low carrier concentration in the system, the screening will be very much more gradual. So you can put in numbers and see what this is a Debye length as a function of, say, doping, just N-type doping. So you have 10 power 18 doping or so, the Debye length will be few nanometers. Okay. So if your device is very large than few nanometer, you don't have to worry. But if your device is comparable to that length scale, then you cannot make a depletion approximation. You have to worry about these things. Okay. Suppose you are working with devices which are very low doping, maybe 10 power 14. Now your Debye lengths are about 200 nanometers or so. Okay. So if your device or junction is off the order of 200, 400 nanometer, you have to worry about this effect. Otherwise, you can carry on with the depletion approximation and there is no issue. Okay. This is a very quick on an NPN. Okay, so we'll look at a transistor example later. So this is NPN again. Okay, so like in a transistor or a MOSFET, both places you get this structure. Again, you can have charge transfer to, for equilibration. You will get charges like this. You can draw a flat Fermi level and very quickly draw this band diagram. So you get a curve like this. What is its consequence? I'll do probably in my last slide.
Now, this is another very interesting aspect of heterojunctions. So you don't have to work with single band gap materials. We have a whole, we have so many materials which have different band gaps. You can bring them together right next to each other and you will get a lot of interesting behavior. So this is what a heterojunction is. Okay? So heterojunctions, so this is material. Okay? So this is a diagram of different materials as a function of their lattice constant. So this, as gentleman was mentioning, that when you integrate two materials on top of each other, you have to do crystal growth. And then you have to worry about that their lattice constants match nicely. Otherwise, when you grow, there is strain in the system and you can generate defects. Okay? So typically, say you want to grow a heterojunction. So gallium arsenide and aluminum arsenide is a very nice system. As you can see, you can go from a band gap of about 1.4 eV or so to a band gap more than 2 electron volt without changing a lattice constant. So you can grow them very nicely on top of each other with different band gaps. Okay? And yeah, people have done these all kinds of calculations for how different band gaps line up. Okay? So the basic idea is, this is one semiconductor, this is other semiconductor. This is their electron affinity. This is their band gap. So this is one type of model which works reasonably fine. So the conduction band offset when you bring these two materials together is given by chi 2 minus chi 1. Okay, so difference between electronegativities. And rest of the valence band offset has now difference of band gaps and this delta EC in there. So if you know these parameters, you can find out how will these two bands line, when these two materials will line up as you align them. Okay? And then this is for all range of materials. People have done calculations and found out how they align. Okay? So very quick example, again, how will you do that? Suppose you have two materials which are both n-type. So this is what happens in a modulation doping kind of example. Okay? So Fermi level for this is somewhere here, for this is here. Now you bring them together. Similar thing again happens. You have a flat Fermi level. You have a charge transfer, electrons from this to this. This part now will have a positive charge. This will have a negative charge. But it's slightly different in this case. As this electron leaves this side, it depletes this side, right? It's losing electrons. It was n-type and now it has less electrons. So this is a positively charged but more depletion kind. This side already had electrons. Now it is getting more electrons. So this is accumulated. It is having more electrons than it had. But so exact shapes will depend on how the charge distribution is. But rough shape is something like this. So positive charge, so you'll have upwards flowing band. Then you have a conduction band offset and a corresponding valence band offset and then a negative slope. And this now is what looks like a MOSFET kind of a triangular well. Okay. And your electron gets confined in the two dimensions. It cannot go this side. It cannot go this side. And this forms the channel of what is called a high electron mobility transistor. HEMT. Okay. Or MOTFET. Modulation doped transistor. So I won't go. So see, some things you have to worry about when you bring two different materials together is there are different boundary conditions. For example, what is the field on two sides? Because typically the dielectric constants can be different of the two materials. So what is needed is that this condition is satisfied, that the normal component of the fields change like this. So if you have a smaller dielectric constant in that material, the field will be higher. So you have to worry about this. For example, you put silicon oxide on silicon. Okay, silicon oxide has a much lower dielectric constant than silicon. So the field, right, if you go one side on silicon, the field is some number. As soon as you go into silicon oxide, the field will be much larger. Just because the electric constant is lower. And this is for wave functions. Okay. So the power of heterojunctions, I'll not go into detail, but if you're interested, you can go to this Nobel lecture by Professor Kroma. So now in a typical material, homojunction, when you apply a bias, okay, this is how your bands will bend. Because band gap is constant. So, electrons go one way, holes go the other way. Like a normal electric field. Positive charge goes one way, negative charge goes the other way. But when you have a band gap variation, You can change all that. You don't have to have a coupled electron hole behavior. You can make a Venn diagram which looks like this. In this case, for electrons, there is no field. For holes, there is a field. Or you can have something like this. Even though electrons and holes have opposite charge, they go in the same direction. Okay. So this is what's called quasi-electric field. So if you're interested, you can go much more deeper in this lecture. Okay. So very interesting aspect. Okay. All right. So now let's come to the third part, which is carrier transport. Okay. So we have looked at two aspects. Now let's look at carrier transport. So now question is, you have these electrons, you have a potential landscape. How do my electrons move? Okay. So here, now transport is a very involved topic. Okay. So it's a lot of things there. So we will look at a very basic picture of it. But there are materials which are perfect. In that case, you get what's called block oscillations, or you have ballistic kind of transport, that your electrons, because of, so in the band structure, they are occupying a state. And as I told you, because of that state, has a certain velocity, which is 1 by h bar d by dk. So just because electron in a state, it already has a velocity. Okay. So you can just start from that picture and do the transport. Okay. And you can get, if you apply a field, you can get block oscillations, or you can get ballistic transport. That's not what we will go into. Okay, but that is one real thing that can happen. Now what you do is, to generate the carriers, you put these dopant atoms in there. Yeah. Because of that, now as my electron moves into the system, through the system, it gets scattered. Also at any finite temperature, my atoms are not sitting still, they are vibrating. Okay. So they generate, they can scatter the electrons by this also. So in this kind of a regime, which is most semiconductors line, we get what's called scattering, and we have mobility, velocity field relations. If you have a lot of scattering, you can go to, you can have mobility, you can define these things. You can have a mobility, you can have a diffusion constant, you can have a velocity field relation. These things don't have any meaning if you don't have a scattering. Okay? So mobility, diffusion constant, they don't have meaning in that sense. Then there are materials which have extremely large disorder. So like polymers. So a lot of us work on organic materials. Okay? Or disordered, amorphous silicon. Disordered materials. Now, the disorder is so much that actually your transport is not through the bands. Okay? It's through the defect states mostly. So you get what's called hopping transport. It's another important regime. And then if you go to very, very small structures, now the electron wavelength itself might start showing up. So this is where we are kind of reaching in our state-of-the-art devices. So very small devices in which there is not a lot of scattering, and electron has a wave nature, so it can reflect back and have interference. Okay. So how to study these? So this is again a very big area of research. Okay. So what we'll quickly look at is this typical one which we have been using traditionally for devices, in which there is significant amount of scattering as electron moves, and we get what's called scattering and mobility field relations. This is a general idea. So I have a material, okay, and my electron or hole, as it moves through this, it gets scattered. And there are few length scales and time constants one should be aware of. So the typical scattering time, it depends on the scattering mechanism. So there are different kinds of scattering mechanisms. As I mentioned, it can scatter from the moving atoms. Yes, these are what called phonons. There can be impurity scattering. So it can be ionized impurity or some other impurity in your metal. There is surface roughness, so like in a MOSFET, you have silicon-silicon oxide interface, which can be rough. And when my electron goes, it can get scattered because of that. There are grain boundary and all kinds of scattering. Okay. So the time period of scattering, the mean time period of scattering for each of them will be quite different. But good number, again, to keep in mind to do any quick calculations and estimates. Typical scattering time would be about 0.1 picosecond or so. Okay. So in 1 picosecond, so in one, if my electron is going through in 1 picosecond, it might encounter on an average maybe about 10 collisions. Okay. Scattering length would be about 10 nanometer or so. Okay. So again, as you can guess,
Now we have scaled our devices so much, we are approaching very close to these regions. So in our devices, current state of the art devices, actually you don't get a lot of scattering. There's few scattering events, but maybe I'm not plot. Okay. And then these mobility and these things are a little bit shaky. And then roughly what is the average energy that you know is k. Okay. So how do we combine? So see, there are different kind of scattering mechanisms. My electron is going, it gets scattered by Kuna. It gets scattered by infrared. It's going with everything. It gets scattered with everything. Okay. So how do you find the total scattering rate? It's essentially 1 by tau is the scattering rate. Right? So you just sum up the different scattering rates. This is an assumption that my electron scattering is independent of scattering from one mechanism to the other mechanism. It's not correlated. So you can sum their scattering rates, something called Matthiessen's rule.
Okay.
So now one way to now have transport is, now because my electron is occupying a state in the band structure, it has a velocity. Okay, so it's always moving around. So when my electric field is zero, there is almost equal chances of it going one way and the other way. So when you draw your cross section for current calculation, half of the time it goes one way, half of the time it comes back. So the net charge flow through that cross section is zero. You don't get much current. Of course, there is a fluctuation because of it though. Okay, so it goes one way. So you can have some noise because of it. But then on an average, the current is zero. On the other hand, when you apply an electric field, it kind of scatters a lot. But then it slowly goes in one direction. So if you have electric field in this direction, there is a force on my electron in that direction. So it gets scattered around, but then slowly it goes in the other direction. So you can characterize the speed at which it goes by something called a drift velocity. It has this effect of scattering included. And as you can expect, that higher is the electric field, higher will be this drift velocity. Yeah, so you started with zero field, zero velocity, this drift kind of a thing. Then you increase field and now it can travel more and more distance. Yeah. And the proportionality constant for this is what we call mobility. Yeah. And mobility is given something like this. So E tau by M star, tau is that scattering time we were talking about. And M star is now your band effects start coming into picture. What is the curvature of the band? And one can do measurements of these velocity field characteristics. For typical semiconductors, it looks like this. So it's a log-log plot. Yeah. So what happens is, as you increase the electric field, your VD indeed increases linearly with the field. And there is a slope which you can define a mobility. Yeah. But as you increase fields to much larger numbers, what you see is that your velocity actually saturates. What happens is, as you increase field within that band structure, my electron goes to higher and higher energy states, and now it can scatter with lot other mechanisms. It can emit phonons also. So it has so much energy, it can hit an lattice atom and lose its energy to that. Okay? Because of that, scattering rate increases quite drastically. And now if you increase field even more, the velocity does not change, because it loses energy very quickly. Okay. So the velocity kind of saturates. Typical numbers again to keep in mind. So saturation velocity is typically of the order of 10 power 7 centimeters per second. Of course, there are some up and down depending on the material. Okay. And the crossover from going from this constant mobility to the saturation happens in about maybe about a few kilovolt per centimeter kind of field. So these are good numbers to keep in mind. So this is how typically mobility would look like. Yeah, so this is for silicon. So as you go to very high temperature, so these all scattering mechanisms are actually temperature dependent, right? Because that, like, that motion of lattice is a function of temperature. If you go to very low temperatures, lattice doesn't move by much. Okay? If you go to very high, there is a lot of motion. So that's what is happening here. If you go to very high temperatures, the mobility, all depending or irrespective of the doping of the sample, mobility kind of approaches same kind of asymptotically same kind of curves. So in very high temperatures, the mobility is kind of limited by the lattice motion mostly. Now as you go
lower temperatures, the lattice motion ceases. It's not much. Now, the only scattering mechanism in the material is the number of dopants you have put in. So, if 10 power 19, you have put lots and lots of dopants. So, at low temperatures, my electron gets scattered with them more and mobility is lower. On the other hand, if you have a sample with very low doping, you have a much higher mobility because there are not many scattering centers. This is something I wanted to just show you, the kind of numbers people have achieved. So this is for modulation doping I was mentioning earlier. Okay. So you see this correlation and this is bulk doping. Here, if you want more carriers, you dope it more heavily, but you lose on mobility. Your mobility falls. So your conductivity of the channel kind of you n increases, mu decreases. So you can go to only some number. Right, you cannot get very high conductivities. But with this modulation doping technique, the carriers are at one place and the dopants are at some other place. And so this is aluminum gallium arsenide system, and where they are going to very low temperatures. So in current state of the art, these systems, people have achieved low temperature mobilities of 36 million. Okay, so this corresponds to a mean free path over 100 microns. Really large. Okay. So one can do a lot of things if one understands how scattering happens and how transport happens in galaxies. Okay, so you can tune these parameters. All right. So your drift current density, as you can say, you now know what is the velocity, you know what is the carrier density. So you can find out this is QNV. This is what we started with. So your V is now mu NE. You can find out what is your drift carrier density in this, drift current density in this case. There is another way in which, even if there is no electric field in your system, but by some means, say you have generated a carrier concentration gradient. You have a lot of carriers in one place, very less carriers in other place, and now you know that each carrier is actually occupying a state in the band structure. Because of that, it has a velocity. Again, on this side, which they are very low electrons, this have velocity also. So they move because of that velocity. And they keep on scattering while the while. But because there are more electrons here and less electrons there, after some while, these electrons will move to this side. Because they are moving and they cannot compensate because there are fewer of them here. So you get a net transport because of that. For example, if you have a Bohr carrier concentration as a function of x, something like this, the electrons will slowly diffuse to this side. And because electrons have charge, they will give rise to a current in the opposite direction. Okay? So you can write this as something like this. So the current will be proportional to this gradient of the concentration. And of course, you know, each electron has a charge E minus E. And then this is the proportionality constant, it's a diffusion constant. Similarly, you can do for holes. Good thing is, now you don't have to find dp again, right? Mu you know is e tau by m, and you can measure it by techniques like Hall effect. But if you know mu, okay, you can directly calculate your diffusion constant by this relation, what's called Einstein relation. All right. So this is how the total drift diffusion transport equation looks like. So you have a drift part, you have a diffusion part, both for electrons and holes. Okay. Now, again, so some cautionary words are this. So see, mu, we defined again in that velocity field characteristics, mu was the slope of that velocity field curve. And as you saw, as you increase the field, the slope changes. Many times people model it like a field-dependent mobility and field-dependent diffusion constant, like the local slope. So when this is valid, this is valid as long as in your device there is sufficient scattering. There is, because you know mobility is e tau by m star. So to define a mean, you should have a sufficient kind of scattering events. Otherwise, your mean does not have a meaning. So if, as long as your device has sufficient scattering events, you can define a tau and define a mobility. But if your device is very small, like in a nanotransistor, when say you are having only two or three collisions, then it's kind of difficult to define them. Okay? So the mobility and diffusion concepts are on a shaky grounds in nanotransistor devices. We still use them because it's very convenient and we are very used to them, but it's on shaky grounds. Okay, so if you get results which don't match, go back to the physics that actually you're not having much scattering events. So actually transport is not drift diffusive. It is actually probably closer to ballistic or maybe just few collisions. Okay, so we have to ask these questions as we are scaling devices. Okay, so I'm getting out of time. So let me just quickly. So this is another thing. So see, we were interested in what is the carrier concentration at each point in the device. So in equilibrium, we calculated that. Now we have currents being carried in the device also. Okay. So now this becomes a coupled problem. Locally, I had some number of electrons, but now there are electrons coming in, electrons going out. Okay. So this local concentration can change. I have to keep track of what is this local concentration. Okay. This is what is done by a continuity equation. So continuity equation essentially tells my local, say in this case, electron concentration, how does it change with time? So there is a term of divergence of J. So if my J is constant everywhere, it does not change. That means the number of electrons that are coming in is same as the number of electrons that are leaving. It does not change the local electron concentration. It remains same. But if J is changing locally, so if more electrons are coming and less are leaving, local electron concentration will increase. On the other hand, it can decrease if less electrons coming, more leaving. Okay? Very simple counting. So this is what a continuity equation is. And then there is other two terms. Locally, you might be generating carriers or they can be recombined. So you just have to keep account that what carriers you started with, and then now when you are operating your device, how does the local carrier concentration goes up or go down? You just have to track it. That's all. There is some typical generation mechanisms we all know. So its temperature is, of course, you can have a local heating source and you can have electron hole pair generation there. Yeah. You can have optical, you can shine light on it, generate carriers, and then you can have impact ionization, right? So you have large fields in your device. Your electron can get accelerated by this field, gain energy equal to the band gap, and then knock off an electron from the valence band and generate an electron hole pair. Okay, so now you started from one electron, now you have two electrons and a hole. Now these can further accelerate, generate more electron hole pairs, and this can have a runoff process. Okay, so this is another mechanism by which you can generate more and more carriers. The carriers can vanish also. Okay, so you can have a reverse process like this. So there can be a band to band recombination by which your carrier concentration now kind of falls. Okay. And then there is Auger recombination, Shockley-Reed Hall recombination. So these are all mechanisms by which your carriers can vanish. And then there are mechanisms by which carriers can come. Okay. So all we have to do is keep track of what is the total mobile carrier concentration at each point in the device. Okay. So we started with something, but now when we are operating the device, there is currents flowing, so that can change the local concentration if current varies with distance. And then there can be local generation of carriers or recombination of carriers. So we just have to keep track and do the counting correctly so that at all times we know what is the local carrier concentration. Sorry? So Auger recombination is kind of a reverse process of this. Okay. So what can happen is this electron, say, recombines with this hole. Okay? Now some energy is being lost, right? It recombines, so you have an EG kind of energy. So where does that energy go? So you can, in light emitting diodes or in LED lasers, right, that goes to photons. You emit light out of it. Auger recombination is a non-radiative mechanism. What happens is this recombines, but that excess energy goes to this electron. And then it goes and then it emits heat. So it just heats up the device, essentially. Okay. That's the recombination mechanism. Okay. Now, so I'm almost out of time. So let me take a few minutes to go over one example to give you some intuition. So we have already looked at PN junction. Okay, so this we already looked at how to draw the Venn diagram for a PN junction. And you know how to calculate field, built-in potential, all that. This we already do, right? So we looked at the Venn diagram kind of a section. This is just some maths if you want to go over it. I just want to give you some intuition. Okay, so if you come to this far, okay, now with bias, what happens? So as you apply bias in this system, okay, so this is the equilibrium case. As you apply forward bias, this barrier decreases. If you apply a reverse bias, because reverse bias, you know this term. So if you apply a positive bias on the P side and a negative bias on the negative side, that is the forward bias. And if you apply reverse, it's the reverse bias. Okay? Now, if you do all that, this is how band diagrams change. Okay? So now I want to, so I started with that relation between how applications are correlated with the IV curves. Okay. So how does this affect the IV relation of this device? So see what is happening. We are changing the potential landscape that the electron sees, not only by the applied, not only by the built-in bias, but also by the applied bias. Here we are making a barrier very small, and here we are making the barrier very large. Okay. So now let me go jump to the current voltage characteristics. Okay. So what happens? So this is the equilibrium picture of the device. Okay. So you have an N side, which has lots and lots of electrons. Right. You have doped it heavily. This is where the Fermi level is. And you know how electrons are distributed as a function of energy. You can do a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution or a Fermi-Dirac distribution. Right. So imagine there are lots and lots of carriers in this lower part of the conduction band. But when they try to go to this side, they see a barrier. They cannot go. On the other hand, if you go to very high energies, okay, there are very few carriers, but they have sufficient energy to go to this side. They can contribute to some flux or current, which is I just denoted by this. Now you look at the other side. Other side, the Fermi level is very close to the valence band. It's a p-type semiconductor. It has lots of holes, but actually a very few electrons. Okay. But whatever electrons are on this side, for them life is easy. They can just slide down the barrier. There is no barrier for them. It's just downhill. Okay. So there are very few electrons here, which can easily go this side. On the other hand, from this side, the electrons which have sufficient energy to go this side are actually very few. So these two fluxes balance each other and you have a net zero current at zero bias. Okay. Now what happens as you apply a forward bias? As you apply forward bias, you decrease that barrier. So you decrease that barrier. Now see, again, think about these two fluxes. On this side, now the number of electrons which have energy to go above this smaller barrier now has exponentially increased because the distribution here is like a Maxwell-Boltzmann, right? So now there are a lot more exponentially larger number of carriers here that have enough energy to go this side. On the other hand, if you look on this side, the number of carriers are still the same. Very few carriers, and for them, they can go downhill, no issues. That part has not changed. So one flux we have exponentially increased compared to the other. This leaks right to exponentially rising current. On the other hand, if you apply a reverse bias, what happens is now this barrier is huge. The number of carriers which have enough energy to go to the other side is exponentially smaller. Yeah, I'm almost done. Yeah, is exponentially smaller. So actually almost no current flows from this side, no flux of electrons. On the other hand, if you look this side again, okay, so you have very few electrons, same as like last time, but their life is still easy. They can just go down the hill. Okay, so
That is the only current component you will get in this case. Almost no other currents. Okay? So you get a current voltage characteristics which is asymmetric because of this. Because you apply a forward bias, there are exponentially large number of carriers that can go that way. While if you go to the reverse bias, there are only very few carriers which can go down the hill and you get a saturated current. Okay? Because essentially this number is fixed and they come downhill. So essentially by manipulating the potential landscape, we get the interesting IV characteristics, which of course then you can use for making rectifiers and all other things. So this is how potential landscapes and all these three things we discussed kind of couple with IV characteristics. Okay. Well, yeah, this is another thing you will see in a lot of other lectures also. Let me just talk about this. So in the forward bias of this characteristics, say you want to change the current by 10 times. How much voltage do you need to apply? Okay. So in this case, say I want to decrease this barrier by some amount by applying bias and increase the current by 10 times. How much voltage do I need to apply? Okay. So because in this case, we have an injection over the barrier, this number is actually fixed, depends on temperature, and you will get at room temperature a number of about 60 millivolts. Okay. So this is a very fundamental limit of all transport that happens over the barrier. Because you have a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, okay, on the conduction band side, so you will have to spend 60 millivolts. You cannot spend less. Okay, you have to give 60 millivolts to increase the current by one order. And this is a very fundamental limit like this. It's called Boltzmann limit. And any device that operates with this limit, this is actually an energy limit also. Because, so you know, charge times the voltage drop is like the energy that you are spending. So any device that operates with this thermionic emission, this is kind of sets the energy limit for that device also. You will see in a lot of the talks, this is the limit for transistors also. So let me just finish with the transistor example. Okay. So this we looked at again. So you have, say, an NPN structure. This you will find in MOSFET as well as in BJT. Now here what is done, this is a three-terminal device. Okay. So you have two pairs of voltages to control these barriers. Just like in a PN junction, you had just one set of voltage. Okay. So here, so this can be emitter source, this can be either bias or gate, this can be collector or drain. So see, what happens is, this barrier, you can apply your forward bias, and again, this is the Fermi level, so you have an exponentially larger number of carriers that can get injected into the channel. And as you decrease this barrier, you can inject more and more number of carriers. On the other hand, you typically reverse bias this junction. So you can pull this down and you try to collect more and more these barriers. So in an ideal transistor, what you want is your VGS or VDE controls this barrier and controls the injection. And this side just kind of collects it. So as long as this bias does not control this barrier height, you get a nice saturated current. But how do you get amplification is, because by applying a very small bias on this, you can get an exponentially large injection of carriers. That's what gives rise to amplification. Okay. So with that, I think this is just the summary. So that these are the three important aspects you should worry about. What is the mobile carrier concentration? Okay. Then what is the electrostatics of the device, and then how does the transport happening? And these are just the set of equations. And with these things, you can engineer the IV characteristics and then get more interesting device applications. Okay. So thank you. And I hope you enjoy the short course.
Thank you, Amit, for the nice lecture. I hope you enjoyed. So we have a short break of, let's say, 10 minutes or so. T is outside waiting. Feel free to ask questions in the break and even later also. And almost all the faculty members, you know, will be here, staying here during the breaks and even other way around. So feel free to ask questions. Thank you. One more thing. So for hands-on, as I said, we will transfer a software in your laptop. So you said number. There is a serial number in your ID. So serial number 1 to 50, if you have your laptops, just take the software pen drive which outside. Okay, thank you.